This video is brought to you by CuriosityStream and Nebula. Let's say you want to produce a multi-cam stream or podcast, maybe with a couple of guests. What would you think you need for this? A few cameras, a couple microphones, sure. But what about to actually capture it all? A big mixer? Multiple capture cards? A powerful PC to switch through all of that in OBS? Right? Well, Roland has thrown their hat into the ring to provide an all-in-one solution that you just plug into your computer and stream with and be off to the races. Let's see if it holds up. I'm EposVox, the stream professor, and we've now looked at quite a few audio interfaces, multi-input capture cards, and all-in-one units like the Blackmagic ATEM Mini and the embarrassment that was the Cooler Engine Stream Engine. How does the Roland VR1 HD hold up? Other than the weird rattle mine has. Before we answer that question, I wanted to give a huge thanks to Micro Center for sending this over to review. There's a lot of higher-end gear like this that I can't always cover on my own budget, so having retailers like Micro Center who can send review samples helps me show more to you all, which is a win for us all. Physically, this is the most impressive feeling unit in this category that I have reviewed. This thing is built like a tank, again, other than whatever the hell is rattling inside there. For video inputs, we have three HDMI inputs, which will accept anywhere from 480i up to 1080p60, a hardware pass-through port for real-time pass-through for presentations or gaming without input latency, as well as a main video feed output for sending to a video recorder or preview monitor, and a control room monitor output that shows the menus and controls. For audio, we get two XLR jacks, one on the front and one on the side, with 48 volts of phantom power available, as well as stereo RCA input and output for line pass-through. The first XLR jack is on the top to allow for ease of access for gooseneck microphones while presenting or DJing. The second XLR and the RCA jacks, as well as the headphone jack, are on the left side. The back also features a DC power plug and a power switch, as well as a securing clip for the power, and then a USB 3.0 A to B for streaming. This shows up as a webcam on your computer and is mostly plug and play. There's also a USB 2.0 Type A port for super basic sound effects or still image graphics loading, but it's very limited. The controls give you audio levels for mixing, separate USB and main audio output levels, sound effects and voice changer controls, auto switching either on a set interval or based on audio activity, and compositing modes for split views and picture-in-picture modes. Let's set up a two-person podcast setup with this. For this, I set up two main cameras for the two hosts of the podcast, myself and my wife, as well as a third angle, which shows us both from a wide-angle lens, all running into the HDMI inputs. Two XLR mics are used to capture our voices, and all of the switching is handled pretty easily. Here's a quick demo.
If you could only play one Pokemon game for the rest of your life, what would it be?
I don't.
If you could only play one game at all for the rest of your life, what would it be?
Guild Wars 2.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Okay.
Thanks
for coming to my show.
Okay. Yay.
The mistake made here was not muting the audio coming in from one of the cameras over HDMI. I found this to be annoying because not only is this probably not desirable to be a default behavior, but I also finding that particular section of the mixer settings involved quite a lot of digging. For the second setup, I'm giving a presentation. Think of this like an educational stream I do sometimes, but also in a classroom. I've got a main camera, a PC input for slides, and a gooseneck mic for me at my, podium. Totally.
Well, this about wraps up today's presentation about why my Discord server is the one Discord server you should ever be joining. Stay tuned after our 15-minute intermission here for the next presentation, which, if I'm reading this right, is why low-spec gamer is the most attractive YouTuber. Nope, you were not supposed to see that. The presentation is about why Charles is our overlord, and we should all obey him. Stay tuned.
For our last setup, here's a basic game stream. I've got my game console ran through HDMI with that pass-through port back to my TV, a main camera input for me, and an iPad capture just to show social media things I'm referencing and things like that, as well as an XLR headset mic connected for my audio.
This new suit's actually pretty cool. Oh, hey. What's up, chat? How's it going? I'm EposVox. We're playing some Spider-Man Miles Morales. I have still, unfortunately, not gotten around to see the movie. Ah, look at the detail. Look at the snow. Weirdly enough, I've not finished this. I have not had enough time for PS5 these days. We're playing on the LG OLED, by the way, and it looks glorious even in 1080p here, which is kind of impressive. All right, there's a crime in progress. We're gonna have to go start it. Get your F's in chat for the people who are about to get their asses handed to them. Ow. Or maybe it's just me. The combat in this game is so satisfying. Appreciate y'all hanging out with me in chat. Check out my latest YouTube video linked below.
The Roland control program for your computer lets you customize the split and picture-in-picture modes and tweak it to your liking to a degree. It won't do a full, you know, layered scene compositing with graphics and such like you could do with a high-end TriCaster or ATEM unit, but combined with some basic graphics and OBS, and you should be good enough for a lot of use cases. Here you can adjust the voice changer, choose your audio samples, etc. Though a lot of this can also be done with the setup menu and dial if you have the menu monitor output HDMI feed running to a screen that you can see as well. The computer software is, however, quite ancient looking. It doesn't scale with Windows DPI scaling, and even with the 150% zoom option in the menus, it's nothing but tiny on a 4K display, and the controls are super cramped and hidden behind sub-windows or extra menus and layers of menus. There is lots of secrets in this software when it comes to super in-depth control over just about everything about your sources, from audio gain, post-processing, signal tweaking, all sorts of stuff. They just bury everything. The initial product concept and first-time setup is super user-friendly, but the software, when you do want to get advanced, is weirdly dated feeling. I'm going to be using this bad boy to produce a fair bit of content in the coming months, much of it content that you won't see here on this YouTube channel. Extended interviews with fellow creators, supplemental educational content, a lot of this stuff is going up on my own streaming site I built with my creator friends. The site is called Nebula, and we've partnered with CuriosityStream. Nebula features YouTube's top education creators such as LowSweatGamer, Thomas Frank, and MKBHD. My videos are higher quality there, ad-free, and often extended from the YouTube versions. CuriosityStream saw what we were doing over on Nebula for educational content and wanted to form an alliance. If you click the link below, you not only get access to CuriosityStream and their library of thousands of documentaries and educational content that they're adding to almost what feels like a daily basis sometimes, but you get access to Nebula and all of our edutainment over there as well. That's two sites for the price of one. And if you've been seeing what LowSpecGamer's been producing recently, whew, good stuff over there. Better yet, CuriosityStream is currently running a special where you can get 26% off an annual subscription, making it under $15 for your first year. For both sites, that's $15 per year. It's absolutely wild. While you're there, check out Top Science Stories of 2021 to learn about all the news-breaking scientific advances and discoveries from this past year. There's a lot to learn about. Head on over to curiositystream.com/epos for the best deal in streaming and get access to both sites for under, again, $15 per year. It's bonkers. Just do it. So what's the catch with the Roland VR1 HD? Well, as mentioned, the HDMI feeds only take up to 1080p 60, and the USB stream output is actually locked to 1080p 30 or lower. This is fine for a lot of broadcasts, but things are moving to higher specs these days, so it does feel a bit behind. Thankfully, you can output 720p 60 if you need to stream 60fps for game streams. That being said, if you supply your own capture card, such as a cheap one like the EVGA XR1 Lite, which can be had from anywhere from like $40 to $65 usually, you can take the main HDMI output at 1080p 60 for a full stream that way as well, which is nice. You could also use the HDMI feed to a capture card for mainstream and the USB feed for like a video call or sending to a guest or something. Of course, no PC gaming formats will work. No 1440p, high refresh rates, ultra-wide, etc. Those rarely work on broadcast gear. While the USB output is limited to 1080p 30 instead of 60, which I find silly, it is in YUI2 format, which is fantastic. This means it's uncompressed, so there's not any artifacting or blocking baked in before you compress it for streaming, and it's low latency, making it easy to sync up with additional audio or video sources. Plus, it is in the proper legal RGB range. Contrast this to something like the ATEM Mini line of products, which only output MJPEG over USB, which only needs USB 2.0, by the way. It doesn't need that much bandwidth, and it's in full RGB range, which means it using anything except a program like OBS, which gives you the ability to manually correct this, it will result in a feed that's way too dark and contrasty to actually use. Kudos to Roland for doing it right here. For audio, you're given up to 60 decibels of analog gain, plus additional digital gain, control, levels, etc. This will struggle a bit to cleanly power high-gain mics like the RE20 or SM7B without mic activators, but it should sound clean for most use cases. You also get post-processing controls with basic EQ, dynamics for compressors, etc. And again, loading graphics from the USB port is super limited to two files at a time in bitmap format, which is eh. The device does do luminance and chroma keying though, which is neat. At the original price of $1,000, this might be a bit of a tough buy in 2021, especially as Blackmagic continues to turn out incremental updates to their ATEM Mini line, but the regular sale prices below $600, such as at your local Micro Center, this is quite competitive with both video mixers and multiple capture card combinations, plus a Stream Deck and an audio interface that you normally need to recreate this functionality with. Not bad. By the way, Just by the way, real quick, huge shouts out to Micro Center for sending this over for the review unit. Often I only get to review cool, expensive stuff like this because of awesome retailers like Micro Center. They're one of the best places to shop for your tech needs, and they have just about everything tech related that you could want in a store, including a custom PC builder tool with same day assembly and pickup available as well. You can't even get same day pickup out of me with videos. I have a link to the Roland VR1 HD on their site, or stop into one of their 25 locations across the US, and you can even get a free 128 gig flash drive and micro SD card as well, apparently. If you're planning on streaming, you probably want to know how to balance that with existing YouTube content, or maybe even shorts. I have a full YouTube channel management 101 video linked here, or down below. Go check it out. Remember, be kind, rewind.